Well, my signal chain in the studio has been the same for a few years now, and I use an Avalon U5 direct box just because it's sort of transparent, and a tube tech compressor that I don't use very hard. I try not to. Every once in a while it'll get away from me, but it's really more for just the VU meter, just so I can regulate volume if I change basses. From bass to bass, you know, sometimes volume change, I can actually see it. That's it. And also, kind of a secret weapon I've got, and it is a Euphonic Audio rumble seed. Euphonic Audio is a really great company, and their background was in reference monitors and stuff, but they can't have bass enclosures, and they're really small and really well tuned and real flat and, you know, really, really good hi-fi stuff. And I because of that, I asked them if they could build an isolation box that was small enough to sit on. And so they did it. And it's, I mean, there are a lot of ISO boxes for basses, but this one is tuned so well. I mean, it's really flat, and it's just got a little 8-inch speaker in it. And so I used that along with a variety of amplifiers to power the thing, and run two lines. So, because typically a bass player doesn't get an amp in the studio, I mean, every once in a while, and this really does sound like an amp in the room. So, that's my signature. Well, do I have to carry it, or is somebody else carrying it?
Let's do a little
If I'm not carrying it, I tell you, one of the amp that I'm loving right now is a Fender Super Bassman, their new. It's all tube, 300 watts, just a mother, man. It's just so good, creamy, good Fender circuitry, you know, really intuitive. And typically, I mean, you know, 410 and a single 15, and their 8x10 is a really great cabinet too. Now, if I'm carrying it, you know, then it can be, you know, it's whatever I've got around the house that I'm going to carry. But I'll tell you what I'm really loving now is a Fender, called a rumble amp, you know. And you can pick it up with one hand, and it's great. So
Fender's, I've thought in recent years, is doing some of the best work they've done on basses and amps.
Yeah.
For many, many years.
Yeah, Fender, they've come back around, you know. There were some dark days there for a while, but they are totally on it now. Their new basses are incredible. I mean, it's like time travel, especially the American Vintage stuff. It's like you go into a mom and pop shop and take something off the wall back in 58 or 63 or whatever, you know, it's like, that's it, man. I mean, really, really great. Man, you know, it's all got its uses, you know. I mean, I'm typically, even with an active bass, unless I really need some kind of quick change, or I'll tell you where an active bass will come in handy for me is if there's a bridge pickup and I need to bump the lows on it. That's where active really comes in handy. Otherwise, I've run everything pretty flat. And typically I'll roll the treble back, you know. You know, it's just like, you never know. I mean, it's something, but there are those occasions where, you know, I might need a little bit more top end or something like that. But typically, even on an active bass, I'll pop it into passive mode. I just like the way this sounds, but better. Typically it sits in the track. A bass can sound too good for a track. You know what I'm saying? It's like a bass played by itself can sound rich and beautiful, and I think that's a problem with a lot of boutique basses, that they sound gorgeous by themselves, but they take up so much room in a track that it's counterproductive, you know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, passive is usually safer, you know. And I feel the same way about, you know, EQs, you know, preamps with, you know, bass preamps with EQs and stuff like that. I think a guy can get himself into some trouble with that, you know. If you got a bass that just sounds good, don't mess with it too much. Besides, you know, you're going to create problems for the engineer later.